I'm Larry Walther. This is principlesofaccounting.com, chapter 15. In this module, we will look very carefully at the calculation of earnings per share. Now, earnings per share is the amount of income of a company divided by the number of shares, or in other words, how much income is generated on a per share basis. It allows comparisons of companies of different sizes. For example, two companies that each make $1 million of profit. If one company had 1 million shares, their earnings per share would be $1 a share. If the other company only had 100,000 shares outstanding, their earnings per share would be $10 per share. Obviously, the earnings of the latter company on a per share basis is much stronger, even though the corporate income is the same. Per share data must be subdivided into continuing operations and income from other categories. So earlier in the chapter, we looked at income from continuing operations, discontinued operations, extraordinary items, that presentation. If we have those components, those special categories of income, then when we show per share data, we're also going to show selected amounts per share for key categories on the income statement. Let's start with the basic earnings per share number, its calculations. It's income available to common shareholders, which we'll better define in a moment, divided by the weighted average number of shares outstanding for the period. We're not going to only take the number of shares at the end of the period, but we're going to look at the average shares outstanding for the period of time in this calculation. Income available to common shareholders is generally the net income of the business minus the portion that's attributable to the preferred dividend requirement of the company. There's some nuances with that, but as a general rule, consider that dividends, whether they're paid to common or preferred, dividends do not reduce income. When we're considering the income per common share of stock, we need to therefore withhold or back out of the net income calculation the amount of preferred dividends so that we know how much income is remaining or available for the common shareholders. The weighted average number of shares outstanding accounts for changes in shares due to issuing additional shares, buying back shares, and so forth. So let's look at a detailed example. This same illustration is reproduced in the textbook. Kuehl Corporation began 2004 with 1 million shares of stock outstanding. 200,000 additional shares were issued on April 1. 120,000 shares were reacquired on November 1. And the net income for the year was $2,760,000. There's some information on dividends. $500,000 in dividends were paid to the preferred shareholders, and $270,000 in dividends were paid to the common shareholders. The basic earnings per share in this case calculates to be $2 per share. It's not at all apparent how that is derived, however, until we look at the specific calculations. That's $2,260,000 divided by 1,130,000 yields $2 per share. We need to dig deeper to see how we get that. Let's consider the net income minus the preferred dividends. The company's net income was $2,760,000 total net income, but remember I said there was $500,000 in dividends for the preferred shares. We're not going to subtract the common share dividends, only the preferred share dividends. So income available to Kuehl's common shareholders is deemed to be $2,260,000. Looking at the weighted average calculation of the shares, we determined it was 1,130,000 by the following process. From January 1 to March 31, the first 3 months of the year, we started the year with 1 million shares outstanding. That's 3 months or 3/12 of a year. So for that phase or that period of time, we can say 3/12 of the year times 1 million shares outstanding contributes 250,000 to the weighted average shares. For the period April 1 to October 31, another 7 months, we had 1,200,000 shares outstanding. That's the million plus the 200,000 additional shares. And so we got 1,200,000 shares outstanding for 7/12 of a year, which comes out to be 700,000. For the last 2 months of the year, we had 1,080,000 shares outstanding. We bought back 120,000. So we'll take the 1,080,000 times 2/12 to get 180,000 weighted average effect. Totaling, we've got our 1,130,000 weighted average. So our income available to common shareholders divided by the weighted average shares gave us that earnings per share number of $2. Some companies need to present a dual earnings per share structure. In addition to the basic earnings per share calculation that we've just looked at, they would also need to calculate diluted earnings per share. These are companies that have potentially dilutive securities outstanding, or in other words, a complex capital structure. For example, a company might have stock options and warrants that entitle the holders to buy additional shares of stock, or there may be convertible bonds or convertible preferred shares that can be exchanged for additional shares of common stock. So diluted earnings per share calculations require a series of assumptions about dilutive securities being converted into common stock. We do a number of what-if scenarios. We assume that convertible preferreds are converted. We assume that convertible bonds are converted, and so on. Anytime that causes a reduction or a dilution in earnings per share, we'll make that assumption to come up with this revised or alternative earnings per share number. So for companies with complex capital structures, you can expect to see two earnings per share numbers, the basic number as well as a diluted earnings per share number.